Hey, what's happening, Cheesecake Nation? It is Supercharged Funk and the Dave blasting at ya with another This Week in Wrestling, No Mercy Edition.
Starting from Sunday and moving to Friday. Everything that we think you should know about, let's get it on.
Alright, so, first match of the night on No Mercy was the pre-show, which was 8-man tag, team face, team heel, who cares? I didn't even bother watching
it. The only thing I can really say about it is, where the fuck are Fabreeze or Brazongo?
Yeah.
Like, they're still doing main events and, like, superstars, so they're not injured. They're better than the Ascension and the Vaudevillains, I'm sorry, but they just are. Like, the only thing I can think of is they're keeping them off TV so that when they can bring them back. So, you know, they haven't been in.
Stop it. What are you doing? You
alright?
Yeah.
Ow. Stab me in the ankle?
Alright, so, now, because there was a, was it a debate going on?
Yeah, the debate, the second one, the second between Hillary and the Donald.
So, they thought it appropriate to put the main event.
We got one other thing to kind of talk about, to kind of cut into a little bit of SmackDown talk. We had the return of the party starter, Curt Hawkins, that's his name. And he assured us he'd have his first match this Tuesday on SmackDown. Spoiler alert. Don't know when it happened. Maybe it was Tuesday before we got there.
Yeah.
So, now let's move on. So, yes, your inaugural match was
AJ Styles, Dean Ambrose, and
Zombie Cena.
John Cena for the SmackDown World title.
It's the WWE World Heavyweight Championship.
Kind of name. I thought it was just the World Champion. The WWE World Championship. No. I'm pretty sure it is.
It's got heavyweight in there.
I don't know. I don't think it does anymore. I think they changed it again.
I go with what the Macho Man Randy Savage said. So everything has heavyweight in it.
The Intercontinental Heavyweight World Heavyweight Championship of the World.
So he could have been the heavyweight champion of the cruiserweight division. Doesn't matter. All right, so continuing on, a pretty damn solid match.
A lot of people thought this was match of the night. I disagree, but again, still a solid match all around, you know.
I had one real noticeable thing kind of pop up in this match. Like Ambrose wasn't in it much.
I was just Dean had like zero offense.
Yeah, he got booted to the outside, took a nap, come back in, get booted to the outside, take another nap.
He just was not a main part of this match. Like, it was mostly AJ and Cena.
Now, there's been a lot of rumors going around that the plan is the following pay-per-view to do Cena versus Ambrose for the number one contenders, and if that's the plan, I guess that makes sense for Ambrose and Cena to mix it up as little as possible. They want to keep that match fresh. I don't think they've had a singles match.
I don't think so.
Other than the one where Ambrose won via the roll-up.
Right.
I think that's their only singles match. You got a lot to work with there. You know, John could talk about, like I don't think John's ever beaten Dean Ambrose.
No.
And Dean can, but John can also kind of play like, oh, well, he used to beat me up with Rollins and Reigns and look where they are in their career and look where you are, kind of like shenanigans-y kind of thing. So it could be pretty interesting. I could be down for that. I'm not a huge fan of either, but together I think they could put on a cool little story. You put AJ out there on commentary, it could be a pretty fun little thing where he kind of screws with both sides.
Yeah.
A little bit of like, who does he want to win, but really he's just trying to make them wear each other down.
Right.
Could be a fun thing. All right, so in the end, well, first we have to talk about the screw jobby protected finish thing.
Right.
All right, so Ambrose locks in kind of a fucked up calf crusher. Not exactly the cleanest version of it, but it's not his move, so I'll give it to him. And then Jan comes in and locks in his STFU, or I don't even know if he's calling what he's calling it now.
I think it's still
his submission deal. So AJ taps with both of them in the submission. The referee calls for the bell. And then immediately goes, "No, wait, I'm a dumbass." Restart the match. Now, there's a couple things they could have done, and I think, obviously, knowing the finish, you couldn't go with A, which would be make an elimination match, and AJ's eliminated, so you have this built-in hype, like, oh shit, we're getting a new champion no matter what, now it's a one-on-one match. Or B, you just do the hard restart, and knowing the finish, we know why. Like, you couldn't do option A. So, everybody starts wrestling again. Cena pretty much was going to win it. And then AJ comes in with a chair, wallops Cena, pins Cena. A little surprising.
Yeah, I remember last week you said that Cena definitely wouldn't go down on a pin. And I agreed. I didn't think that they would do that.
Well, I also called that Cena would be the guy to hit the move and then AJ would roll him out and win. So I thought he'd get the pin on Ambrose. But Cena took the pin, which I have to give him credit
for
because he didn't... You don't really... It doesn't look bad for you, well, especially for John Cena to lose. It just doesn't.
Right.
But to lose to a weapon shot, pretty protected, but...
Yeah.
AJ goes up now. He's up 3-0. So I can only imagine Retribution's coming, and his name is John Cena. He's put AJ over 3 times now, so...
Yeah. All right, you guys are going to have to forgive me, because I didn't, again, the pen I had ran out of ink, so I had to take notes after the fact. So if these matches are out of order, please forgive me. I will try to remember them as best I can. Next up was, I want to say it was the tag match?
Sounds about right.
All right, so either way, guys, if it's not, we're just going to scroll through.
Yeah, it doesn't matter if it's in order or not, really.
So we'll talk about the tag match.
There's only one match that matters being in order, and it's the main event, because it's going to kind of talk about something that happens after.
Right. All right, so Usos versus Slater and Rhino.
Who they're really, really pushing for this Beauty and the Man Beast name. Yeah. So it's like, all right.
What kind of noises are you making? I heard you make those noises.
It was a pretty solid match, but... I like them, but without these vignettes week to week, it's getting kind of hard to be like,
yeah,
Heath and Rhino should be the champions, because...
Yeah.
Heath is pretty solid in the ring. Rhino does his things, but he's showing his age pretty badly.
Yeah, like, most of this match was Rhino getting beat up. Heath was the hot tag, but then, you know, somehow Rhino was still getting beat up, but then he came around.
What do you think of Heath's offense?
I don't know, man. Like,
it's a little hokey to me. He throws some weird punches for like them to be like, he's a former Golden Gloves boxer, but then he's like throwing these like weird John Cena looking punches where he's like throwing them like this, like he's gorilla punching. Like, I get it, because it's one of those things they teach you in wrestling. You like, you want to make sure you move big to everybody, so the guy in the farthest toppest row can see what you're doing.
Right.
So like. But everything else he does looks pretty straight. But for his gimmick to be, I'm a puncher, he throws some fucking goofy punches.
Yeah.
Like, I don't want him to be Steve Blackman and out there, like, throwing, like, punch combinations where it's hard to sell for him. But, yeah, this was a clinic by the Usos. And then the finish to the match.
Yeah. It's somehow or another, they felt that they should keep the belts on...
Rhino, they had to put over Young Man Rhino. So Young Man Rhino, because he needs that rub off the Usos, comes flying around the corner, takes out one Uso, runs in the ring, takes out another Uso, drags Heath to the corner, gets the tag, then immediately Gore and wins. I was like, oh.
Very interesting indeed. So
Rhino pretty much murdered the Usos by himself.
Alright, so next up we'll do... Nikki versus Carmella. Why not?
I think that actually was the next one. I think you're going in order so far.
Alright. So, again, this is just a little grudge match. No, not the worst match no more, but this is definitely meant to be one of the P-break matches. SmackDown.
Yeah.
I don't think you guys are missing anything. Because they've had decent matches in the past, you know, and this definitely was
still a good... I mean, Nikki's definitely improved. Carmella's still not great.
Yeah.
She's got some cool stuff. I like Carmella a lot more on the ground.
Yeah.
Her ground game is a lot better than her standing game.
Right.
Which works in real fighting, real fighting, but not so much in pro wrestling. But her working through everything... That was cool. I like the code of silence reversed into the Alabama slam.
How do you like her submission? I don't know if I've asked you this question before.
The code of silence?
Yeah.
I dig it.
I think it's different. Nobody actually does anything like that. It gives her something. But at the end of the day, Nikki...
It's definitely a choke, and it's weird that they're trying to pretend it's like a neck submission.
Yeah.
Like, no, it's definitely like a 3/4 face lock, but with your leg.
Yeah. But at the end of the night, Nikki finally gets a win over Carmella. But as we'll see later on, their feud is still going strong. So we'll get to that. I want to say Dolph Miz was next.
Yeah, because I think the other ladies' match was kind of the spacer.
Yeah.
All right. So I have to come clean. I didn't think... Before this pay-per-view, I was like, I wasn't really super into this match.
Yeah.
This was a good fucking match.
Yeah, for me, this was match of the night. This is my opinion.
Yeah, easily. This was match of the night for me, too. Alright, so, Dolph and Miz, just great stuff. I can only really nitpick a couple spots that I didn't like. That Dolph kicked out of two of Miz's finishers. I just don't like the finisher kick out spots. One is fine.
Yeah.
Two is a little extreme.
Yeah, when you...
Kind of
go
I get the idea,
before.
Though. It's like Dolph is fighting for his life. But yeah, really good stuff.
Yeah. Miz uses every like little underhanded trick in the heel playbook.
Yeah, he got...
He uses a weapon. He used the spray. He calls out the goons.
He undid
the turnbuckle. God, I'm pretty sure I don't think he rolled up the tights.
He did try to go and put his legs on the ropes.
He did. He did do that. So just about every
this
heel maneuver, Miz tried and just would not work for him this week.
But I've got to give the points not to Dolph, but Miz. Miz put in the work and a half.
Oh, absolutely.
Like, granted, Dolph is really good. I'm not trying to take anything away, but this was the Miz clinic.
Oh, absolutely.
Miz did.
These guys put on.
Miz showed that all those people that say Miz is a bad wrestler, you know, all this bullshit, they're wrong.
Yeah, absolutely.
This was this.
This was a great match. I mean, yeah, definitely one of my favorite matches of the year. It was just super entertaining. You know, you really weren't sure whether Dolph was going to come out of this or not, and that's the kind of match you want.
Yeah, like, this was just really good. And a big, big clap to WWE for doing a good job of selling Dolph could be leaving.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Because usually they kind of don't do a good job.
No, they don't.
It's like, oh, is John Cena going to be fired? Oh, who knows? No? Oh, look at that.
But yeah, this was definitely just all the promos up to this were great, so full of emotion, especially from Dolph. Even The Miz, like, he just, these two, it
this felt like this was very... Miz's return to, like, I assume he was like, hey, I've been putting over a lot of guys, I've been doing all your movies, doing all your press stuff, like, kind of get a little bit of a little thank you, and like, this was his opportunity. I mean, I'm sure in the back, like, he's in that boys' clique.
Yeah.
And it's going to be a major thing when we get to SmackDown. I had one gigantic issue with that. But this match, just phenomenal.
Yeah, absolutely. Great job. Definitely match of the night for us. And goes without saying, Dolph picks up the win and is your new Intercontinental Champion.
All right, assuming Miz doesn't get the title back from Dolph, like Dolph wins it wherever down the line, who do you see as the next challenger for Dolph? Because the obvious answer is Corbin, but I think people are already burnt out on Dolph and Corbin matches.
Yeah, I think it'd be a while before we got that.
But I don't see them having anybody else built up. Like, the only other person I could see is Wyatt, but I think Wyatt's above that.
Yeah, you never know, man. You never know. That's the thing right now. Like, they're kind of stacked for, like, a higher card, but their mid-card is kind of drained.
Yeah, there's so much in the tag team division. Like, I don't know who could go up for the IC. I mean, granted, you could always have somebody like a Randy Orton and have Dolph and Orton for a while. Like, that could be a couple of really good matches. Though I'm kind of, after the main event of SmackDown, I'm kind of thinking Orton might be back to Robo Orton.
Alright, well, we will get to that. Next up we'll do... Fuck it, we'll do,
Actually, wasn't there a Swagger?
Yeah, that was the Swagger versus Baron Corbin.
I'm a Swagger guy, and this was just not good.
Yeah, this was definitely probably the worst match of the night, unfortunately.
Like, it wasn't horrible, but it was just plodding and just kind of boring.
Yeah, this was not an entertaining match, really.
Boring Corbin earned his nickname.
Yeah.
He was put in charge of offense, and
he did not deliver.
Yeah, he just didn't have anything exciting. The only cool spot was the finish.
Yeah.
Was the reversal into the end of days. He's got a cool finish, but that's really all I could say about Corbin right now. Like, his offense is just not that impressive. And for a monster heel, that's not good.
Yeah, so...
That's where you need to make your bread and butter, is on your offense, and he's...
Yeah, I think they're going to keep continuing this feud, so here's hoping that they learn from their past mistakes and they can actually give us a good match later down the road. Alright, so what was going to be the women's match of Becky versus Alexa Bliss? Unfortunately...
Becky's appendix burst?
Is that what happened? Oh, shit.
So she had to have emergency surgery. That's why she wasn't there.
Yeah, so... Luckily, she should be back within the next couple weeks, hopefully. But
it was really weird they wouldn't just say that.
Yeah, like...
They're like, a non-wrestling injury. I'm like, she in rehab? Like, what the fuck? Why are you
So, Alexa Bliss, you want to tell the little story about what you thought was going to happen? And then you got all depressed because it didn't happen?
Oh, okay. So, like... I don't remember what exactly there was going on, but like there was hints that it was possibly going to be Asuka. And I was like, oh, that'd be awesome. Just like Asuka comes up for one show, kind of like what Bayley did, and then just come back down to NXT. Like, she's calling out, like, I'm the best woman, no one can beat me, na-na-na-na-poo-poo. And then, like, Asuka comes out, and, like, yeah, most of your crowd's stupid, fucking dirty, filthy, smelly casuals. But all of us, real wrestling fans... worship at the altar of Asuka. So she just comes out, just destroys Alexa Bliss, and leaves. But no, they sent out Naomi. Kind of an alright match. Roll up finish. Kind of my least favorite, because it's just the least definitive
thing
possible. So, did you watch Talking Smack, like, they attached it to the end of No Mercy if you watched it later.
No, I didn't get a chance yet.
It's alright. It wasn't a whole hell of a lot of really important things. They had Dolph on, and he kind of, like, the only really cool thing about it was he kind of shot on him. He's like, I think our match should have been the main event, me and Miz. I think we were, you know, we had, our story was built up, and Shane was kind of like, yeah, but we thought Orton, and you kind of tell there's a little bit of, like, yeah, but our match was better.
Yeah.
So, like, that was kind of cool, just to see, like, a little bit of Shootsky tension.
Yeah.
Because you could obviously tell, like, Ziggler feels like he should be a bigger star than he is.
Oh, absolutely. So,
like, alright, but you also had Alexa Bliss on there, and they were kind of talking and hinting that they're probably going to do a triple threat with the ladies, which, you know my thoughts on triple threats as of right now, but... I assume they want to let Becky kind of come back at her own pace. So, triple threat, you kick her to the outside for most of the match, let the other two fresher girls work. Becky comes in, hits her straight fire, and then gets her victory. So I can totally understand that. Like, as a practical sense, I can't be against that. Booking sense, it makes sense.
Yeah.
So yeah, pretty solid little match, but it ends in a roll-up. What are your thoughts on Naomi? Like, you're a pretty big fan of her, right?
I love Naomi. She's, I don't know, like, Becky is my favorite. Just, and in terms of, like, if Naomi was, like, as good.
Are you saying Becky's your favorite, period, or just SmackDown?
Period.
She's above my, anybody in NXT, too?
Yeah, I mean, in terms of female wrestlers, man, I just.
It's fair. I mean, everybody got their pick. I was just surprised. Because you don't really hear Becky too often. It's usually one of the Raw girls, somebody from NXT.
Yeah, I just really like Becky. I just think she's that good.
We all know where I worship. I said it earlier.
I mean, like, Naomi, she's just a, like, if she was just slightly better.
My only issue with Naomi is she's, like, a super athlete, but she's just a little sloppy.
Yeah, that I couldn't have said it better myself. Like, she's fun to watch. Like, she's, again, a great athlete. She's... love that gimmick. Like, it's such a cool gimmick. But, yeah. That's... So, I like Naomi.
Get her some goddamn merchandise. I say it every week, but I'm going to say it again. Why does she not have glow sticks to throw to the kids and the kids to buy? And like,
Yeah, you're more than willing to put bootios down fucking Big E's
trunk.
E. And fucking...
hanging out with Big E's trunk. Yeah, so get her some goddamn glow sticks, WWE. Like, Jesus Christ, what does a box of glow sticks cost when you buy them in bulk? Don't sell them shits. Get her some black light, dumb shit to sell to the kids, make her some money. Goddamn, you know, bring in some money, young man Uso could use a little extra money, let's just say that. Christmas is coming up. Get them kids some nice shits.
Alright, so the... the real main event of the night was Bray Wyatt versus Randy Orton.
That's my general thoughts. It was alright.
Yeah.
Orton is slowly reverting back to salty Orton. Like, I got a feeling they were kind of like, oh yeah, we got this feud, and I think we're going to kind of slowly move you guys away, and we'll figure something out. And he just, like, rumble Orton, please insert power slam. RKO. I don't know, he just...
Yeah, he's... Eh, it was kind of noticeable, but...
Like, when he's on, Randy's really good, but this just felt like they must have told him before, like, oh, you're losing tonight, and he's just like, fuck that. So,
but the one thing we knew that we have been talking about for the last couple weeks finally... fucking happened. Luke Harper shows up out of nowhere, helps Bray win the match. Bray Wyatt has finally won a match, folks.
Where's Eric Rowan?
I don't know.
I'm gonna keep this point fresh because it's gonna come back to haunt us. Alright, so that was pretty much No Mercy. What'd you think of it compared to some of the other shows recently?
It was decent.
I really enjoyed this show.
Oh, I thought it was decent. I thought it was really good.
And I gotta say, I went into this a little bit on the old salty side.
Yeah, I honestly
watched the debate, so a lot of the matches got spoiled for me. But even with the spoiled knowledge, I went into this and really enjoyed it.
Oh, yeah. Like, the one match I was looking forward to was Dolph and Miz. Like, and the fact that that was the best match out of all made me even like it even more. Because I was afraid it wasn't going to be that good. I'm just happy Bray won. You know, it could have been a better match, but man, I'm just happy Luke's back. I'm happy that Bray finally fucking won a match. The triple threat was good. I'm really sad Becky didn't get a chance to wrestle, but hey, Naomi got to wrestle. Looked good doing it. Kind of disappointed that Slater and Minoris. I like Slater. I mean, I think they're fun tag team, but I honestly think the Usos should have
gotten the belts. Who's the best tag team on SmackDown right now?
Whew, that is a toughie. I know Usos are definitely up there. I mean, I'm not 100% on American Alpha.
I think they're good, but I think they're super overrated in terms of getting over with casuals.
Yeah, I think I would have to agree on that. For right now, I'm just gonna have to say the Usos. Like, I just,
I think if you ran Fabriz as faces and let them play up the comedy, I think they.
I think you're right.
So far past Slater and Rhino, I think it could be amazing. You just let them come out, just be two good-looking guys that get over. They do some goofy, like, supermodel comedy. But I think it's old-school thinking that's like, oh, they're good-looking guys. They got to be heels. So I think that's kind of what's holding them back. Because I think they've got the comedy chops to be, you know, top guys.
Absolutely.
Until the Revival comes.
Yeah.
Because they go hard all day, all night.
All right, guys. We normally go into Raw, but because this was a SmackDown pay-per-view, we'll just kind of go immediately into SmackDown.
Yeah, it makes sense. I like that.
All right, so we'll see you in a sec.
Alright, time for some SmackDown talk.
Alright, so, right out the gates, we got a tag match with Randy and Kane. Wait, was this the first match?
That was the main event.
Oh, why the hell did I write it first? Again, guys, my fucking notes are all over the goddamn place. No, it was Dolph. Did I write them backwards?
Yeah, I think so.
I think I wrote them backwards.
The handicap match was the first match.
Yeah, okay. Sorry, guys.
So I wonder, now that we've
take
had
the
Suicide Squad... Oh, I did find out some stuff, why the other two Suicide Squad... Or
Spirit. It's been a long day, guys. It's been a long day for us both.
Alright, so getting back to it. The two Spirit Squad guys that aren't around... One is retired from wrestling, and he's, I think he's like a Orthodox Jew or something, like something, some religion that he can't wrestle, and the other guy, I think, is outside the country, something like that. So yeah, there's like legitimate reasons they aren't there. It's not like just WWE was like, oh, just bring in two.
That's kind of an odd stipulation in a religion.
Well, it's, you know, they can't, like, eat anything delicious for you, probably. I'm sure it's like all vices you can't do. Can't like go out there and beat the shit out of somebody.
Alright, so yeah, we got Dolph coming up, you know, his congratulatory walk around the ring, you know, giving us a little heartfelt speech to the fans. Miz clearly not having any of that.
Did you notice what shirt he was wearing? Old Dolph.
I did not.
He's wearing a Hype Bros t-shirt.
That's right, he was.
And keep that in mind, listeners, possibly viewers. I don't know what you do. If you're like me, you just throw these kind of things on in video game or whatever. So I just assume you're listening. All right. So yeah, he's wearing a Hype Bros t-shirt. Spirit Squad comes out with to challenge Dolph effectively. And Miz is like, yeah, you're going to lose in a handicap match. So Dolph wins on some shady stuff. Just, you know, he's Dolph. He's better. Kenny looking pretty damn good.
Mikey, not so much.
Yeah, Mikey, not so much. Not quite in the same league.
Same, not quite a hit in the gym as much skinny is.
Yeah. He's not rocking the fucking 12-pack. Jesus, Kenny wants to get back into WWE. Mikey, not so much. Seems like he would have been happy with his life on the outside.
So, listen at home at night, and some of the cheese doodles want to sing them on the cartoons.
So yeah, so Kenny was pretty good. I think you offer him a contract, and I'm like, not so much. But alright, so then Miz comes in, and you got a 3-on-1 beatdown on old Dolphinstein. And then the tag team comes down to rescue him. Which one should it be? I don't know, he's wearing a Hype Bros t-shirt.
We know that...
Zack Ryder in the middle of the fucking promo.
Fucking...
So the Hype Bros come out. Oh, wait. That makes way too much sense. Let's just send down the other random face tag team so Jables can be like, I don't know why he came down here, but I'm sure Dolph's happy. Is there a reason? Who the fuck knows? Like, why can't we just make Stables back a thing? Like, Hogan had mates, why can't Dolph just have, like, the Hype Bros as his friends? Like, they don't have to do anything. They don't have to be, like, a six-man stable.
Yeah, it's
like
not like...
They're just friends.
I mean, it's not like fucking, like, Dolph is a heel anymore, and like he's having that like little fake feud with Zack Ryder anymore. Everyone knows they're best friends in real life. Like,
yeah, just
like let me a thing.
Yeah, I miss like the days when wrestlers could just seem to be friends with people like Steamer and Tito. Like, they weren't really a tag team, but when one was getting their ass kicked, the other would come out and be like, hey, and, like, save them. Like, just let that shit happen. Like, we don't need a stable, we don't need to really, like, name drop it, but for, like, the hardcores, the non-horribly disgusting, smelly, putrid, filthy casuals could pick up on that shit and be like, oh, that's cool. Like, they're friends and they're gonna come save each other.
Yeah, so, like, some reason they felt the need to send out Heath and Rhino.
So, whatever. Alright, so...
Alright, I'm literally just going to go...
Vertically?
So, whether this is right or not, you know, again...
That sounds right.
We're gonna do Carmella versus Naomi.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. That's my general thought of this match. Yeah.
Yeah, again, this was just blah. Nikki comes out. Gives a distraction. Naomi gets the win.
Via roll-up, my least favorite of all.
Moving right along. Chad Gable versus Jimmy Uso.
I like the Uso's little cheek thing at the end. He rolled in and put his feet on his ass.
Yeah, that was pretty interesting.
That was neato.
Nice little Healy work by the Usos in a singles match. Always good.
I like the Usos getting more and more shit together for, like, their gimmicks.
Yeah, yeah.
They got, like, bandanas now and shit. Like, oh, that's kind of working. They're starting, yeah. Like, they started out like they were going to, like, the cheap aisle in Walmart. Now they're starting to look fresh. I'm digging it. I like it.
So, yeah, this was just a quick little match, you know. Nothing too much going on for it.
I gotta wonder, though, when are they going to fucking flip the switch on American Alpha? Because they're not doing anything but losing. At some point, you gotta put over American Alpha, the filthy, smelly, putrid, disgusting, bottom-feeding, filthy casuals. They don't know anything about these guys. And, oh, you're like, he's the greatest guys ever, and the worst.
Again!
Look at that, Mara, they're the best. At losing? And then you have, like, Otunga's like, oh, they're pretty good, they do the headlock. And then Mara's like, that was a Japanese 3/8 quarter neck toss. Invented by Morifuji Shinagawa.
Back in 1987!
Like, thanks, Mar.
I wish I could understand half of what he's...
Or a wrestler who's even older than Ron Simmons. Like, I remember when Moses used that on the Pharaoh.
Like, I was there. I saw it. Don't you... I can prove it. Yeah, kind of, maybe. Don't ask me to.
So, yeah, this was... They gotta put over America up at some point, because they're like, oh, great, they can beat the Ascension. They're obviously top guys. So, yeah, they gotta start putting over somebody, because that's kind of my one issue on SmackDown right now. It's the 50-50 booking is getting a little strong on SmackDown.
Yeah, speaking of the Ascension, I wonder what they're gonna be doing, because they're clearly building up something with the Hype Bros.
They're gonna lose. They're going to lose to the Hype Bros. Because I assume the titles are going to the Usos. Yeah, I don't know how or when, but that seems like the way. They're building all their face tag teams, so I assume the Usos, by hook or by crook, are going to try to keep American Alpha out of the title picture for a while, and they're going to beat the other face teams to kind of build up the Usos. Then maybe Mania time, American Alpha, Usos, Barn Burner. Hopefully they do something cool. I've heard a couple ideas for matches. I'm hoping ladder match. Uso's American Alpha ladder match could be awesome.
I agree. That would be great.
For Mania. So, we'll see.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen. I don't know how you felt about this whole segment, but AJ Styles came to the ring and announced that he was going to give somebody an opportunity to have a match with him. Dean comes to the ring, being all pissed off and whatnot.
How Dean seems to think he deserves a title match after losing twice.
But, I mean, he still technically has his own rematch.
Still, but at the same time, winning at some point.
Yeah, but we find out that obviously it was not Dean who he's to have a fight with.
But James the Chinless Wonder Ellsworth.
Any man with two hands has a fighting chance.
Ellsworth, Dean actually dropped Ellsworth 316. Any man with two hands has a fighting chance. Yeah. I thought this was great. And then, you know, the whole back and forth, you know, we get Daniel Bryan coming out saying that the match will go on, but Dean gets to be the special guest referee.
This was a little shenanigan-y. Like, I get what the actual point is, but, like, I don't understand why Daniel Bryan doesn't like AJ Styles. Like, it makes sense with Miz, because Miz was a complete douche nozzle, but, like, he wasn't even this mean to Miz. Like, what is your problem? That your fucking bro-in-law Cena can't beat AJ, so it's like, let's fuck with him? Like, I don't understand why he hates him so much. He's literally copied John Cena's things that he says.
But I don't know. I thought this was pretty funny. I enjoyed it. You know, I felt Dean pulling the shit out of his pockets. He had like a million things in there. Then he just randomly stops to talk on the phone.
It brought back bad memories to me. Because this feels like hokey slapstick Dean. But I know there's definitely people that like that Dean more than serious.
Yeah, I kind of do. I'm going to be perfectly honest. I kind
of
do. Like,
I don't think you're alone, because ever since he stopped the slapstick Dean and went more of a serious Dean to try to, like...
Yeah.
He doesn't feel like he should be a world champion. I think that's the issue. I think everybody wanted the Shield to be three world champions, because in the long run, that gives validity to saying the Shield is one of the best things. Like, granted, wrestling is based on revisionist history, so no way they're not going to pretend like, oh, all three were world champions, even if, you know, for a little bit. But I feel like they gotta move Dean down. Like, he could be a great IC champion.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. Like, he just needs to build up the comedy more. Maybe not get so serious. Maybe when he, like, something like bad happens to him, he can kind of put on the pissed off face, but when push comes to shove, he's much better as a comedy.
I think especially as a face, he needs to stick with the comedy.
Absolutely.
Maybe when they decide they want to, you know, flip that switch and let him go straight up, like,
heel.
Cactus Jack heel.
Yeah.
Then maybe he's got an argument for world champion. But I think Face Dean is just not world champion.
I completely agree. I mean, I'm not a huge fan of Dean. I don't know if I'm ready to buy his t-shirt or anything like that. But I like the guy. But he just needs that little tweak. Merlin, what are you doing?
She just came running across, rubbing her ass the entire way.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
She stopped. She jumped up on the footstool of the chair and slid on her ass all the way to my leg.
But all right. James Ellsworth threw some Dean shenanigans.
A lot of Dean shenanigans.
Gets the pin over AJ, so... Kalu-Kale.
Yeah, it was... It was. During talking smack after the show, Daniel Bryan confirmed that next week James Ellsworth gets a title shot against AJ.
Oh, no shit!
So you got that to look forward to. Naomi will get a match with Alexa Bliss, and if Naomi wins... According to Daniel Bryan, him and Shane will have to talk about her being included in the match, which seems like the obvious triple threat that I kind of talked about earlier. Mm. And, there's one other match he confirmed. Oh, Swagger and Corbin. They're going to have a rematch.
All right, guys. So, the fun alarm. Moving along to the main event that I mentioned at the beginning of the video.
That's the Corbin Swagger funnel alarm. Alright, so your main event of the evening.
A tag team match between Randy Orton and Kane versus Bray Wyatt and Luke Harper. Gotta say one thing, though. I know it pisses you off and it pisses me off. When they brought up Kane's little card thing at the beginning, they said one of his nicknames is the Big Red Monster. Fuck you!
Revisionist history dick knobs.
We know for a goddamn fact that he's the Big Red Machine.
Yeah, I don't understand why they changed it.
They did, like, even on the, I think the last time we even saw Kane in a match, Mauro called him the Big Red Machine.
it's his nickname.
Or maybe it was JBL. I can't remember who did it, but I know somebody fucking did.
Somebody got
caught. He's the big red machine.
Why is your belly wet?
What are you doing? With your little tongue sticking out. Kind of like get that little bub support going on here. You're kind of like a skinnier, like fuzzier little bub.
I'm just trying to block her so she doesn't jump up there.
Alright. Alright, so that little distraction.
What'd you think of the Wyatt mysticism finish? Kane has disappeared.
I mean, I think it would have... I don't know, man.
It would have been a billion times better if it was fucking Eric Rowan. Or if, like, you did the whole match and it was actually, like, Kane takes off the mask and it's Eric Rowan.
That would have been cool.
Like, he comes in, hits the choke slam, was, what the fuck? And he's like, and it's Eric Rowan under the mask. Like, I don't know how they could have worked the beard into it. Like, stick it up on his face, tape it up. But, like, that could have been something cool. Like, where the fuck is Eric Rowan?
Yeah, like, they never really explain why he's not hanging
like,
around.
We just got back Harper, and now Rowan disappears. God damn it. And they're also trying to play it off, like, on Talking Smack, like, Bray's like, I finally got my brother back. It's like, wait, Bose? So, yeah, it was just weird. And, like, he also wasn't there for SmackDown or the Talking Smack segment. Well, we saw him just before the pay-per-view. Like, he was doing the Randy Orton segments. Bring back Eric Rowan. Like, fucking... I like him as a tag team. Unless they're planning on doing Bray and Harper as the tag team. That's the only thing I could think of, because... they would make a legit two-man thing for American Alpha to come up with. Like, if you build the Usos up, and then, like, Usos are like, we'll take an open challenge for anybody we haven't already beaten. So, like, American Alpha, like, ah, shucks. And then lights go out, lights come back on, and it's the Harper and Rowan, and it's like, fuck. And then Bray and Harper beat him. Could be cool. That's my only thought, is where the fuck Eric Rowan is.
Yeah, man, like, I don't know what they're planning in. I just don't. But yeah, King just fucking disappears.
I assume Eric Rowan ate him under the ring.
And Bray gets another win, so I really don't care.
Alright, what do you think of Randy's taking of a Sister Abigail? He, like, fucking...
I'm trying to remember.
He effectively did nothing. He, like, kind of fell on top of Bray as opposed to, like, rolling through. Like, super sandbagged it.
Yeah, he did, didn't he?
Like, I was just like, yeah, there's Robo Randy. He's back in full swing. He's like, I'm not putting anybody over. Fuck this. Like, I was just like...
But, in the end...
I guess I can't blame him. He's just like, he just came back from, like,
yeah,
neck surgery. Like, all right, what's the first thing you're going to do? Like, oh, you're going to put over young man Brock Lesnar. All right, and then I'm going to get some heat back. Like, oh, yeah, you're going to beat up Randy. Oh, wait, no, you're not. Kane will. He's like, oh, okay. And then I get my revenge against him. Oh, no, then Harper will be back and he'll kick your ass. Oh, yay. Yeah, and then the next night you'll also lose again. Cool. So yeah, I guess I can't blame Orton for being a little bit on the PO train, but yeah, he's kind of reverting back to Robo Orton. Hits his spots and gets the fuck out of there. So alright guys, let's
roll right
take
on
a pause for the cause and move on to a Monday Night Raw.
Would you like to start things off?
Monday, motherfucking Raw. Alright, so we're gonna kick this shit off.
Well, do you want the notes? No, you just want to take it over?
I know what it started out with, but it's just gonna anger up the blood to talk about it. All right, so you had Sasha was the first one out there, right?
Yep, she was the first one out there.
So she cuts her promo, and it was all right. I'll give it to her. All right, not a bad promo. Then Charlotte comes out and kind of cuts her retort, and they're like, Hell in a Cell, it's going to be awesome and stuff. And my immediate thought is, rest in peace, Sasha. I can just imagine you're going to fall off and land on your head. Then Rusev comes out with his, or no, it was Lana first, right?
No, it was like, Charlotte was coming out, and then Rusev cut her off.
Oh, yeah. And he cuts his great, just D-knob fucking, like, no one cares about women matches. Get out of here, little girls. I have man stuff to talk about. I was just like, Rufus. And he's got no goatee, which is in his actual, like, picture. And now he just has, like, mutton chops up the side of his face, which is terrific. And it might be the style I'm going to go with for, I'm going to have to shave this part off and, like, leave the sides. Because it looks good on Rufus, so it must look good on everyone. So then he starts talking about the Women's Revolution, which at this point, they cut it in half and they're kind of feeding it on scraps. Like, Raw is really kind of forcing it, and SmackDown is just kind of like, it's all right. So the women team up and attack Rusev from behind with a drop kick to send him out of the ring, which weird. Neither one is like a very impressive specimen compared to Rusev. So he gets back in like he's going to kick both their asses. And the lone fucking...
Boot him! Boot him!
Worst thing in wrestling. Boot him! That was out to a loud, loud chorus of boos. Because apparently...
That little tiny bit of cheering with an insurmountable amount of boos, so it kind of sounds like a roar.
Yeah.
Like some sort of Godzilla monster in the crowd.
So yes, apparently the crowd really wanted to see Charlotte and Sasha versus Rusev. That could have been amazing. Amazingly brutal. So they kind of break it up and they're going to have a match later, which makes no fucking sense. Because obviously, Rusev doesn't give a shit about Charlotte, and why does Charlotte like Rusev? He just insulted her directly to her face multiple times in one segment. This bad booking.
Yeah. Hey, we're getting the first women's Hell in a Cell, so that's something.
We'll see when we're all at the fucking Sasha Banks Memorial Raw event. Everybody's wrestling with little SB fucking black armbands like Eddie Guerrero's. Because she fucking tried to do a shooting star press off the fucking Hell in a Cell. Like, she gets injured in every goddamn match. How is she going to do a Hell in a Cell? She got injured falling off the top of the things onto the ropes and she, like, snapped in half. Mm. How the fuck is she gonna do a Hell in the Cell? Like, I'm not saying all women can't, but Sasha Banks can't. She can't make it through normal matches without fucking looking like she's dead. So I got a feeling it's gonna be a Hell in the Cell in name only. Like, maybe a couple throws into the cage. Maybe a face rake. But I don't see them leaving the hell.
Yeah.
The cell, I should say.
They don't really have the body mass to break it down, really.
Oh. I don't know. I feel like they might leave the door unlocked, but I feel like they're going to want to climb, but Jesus Christ. Well, like, how often Sasha Banks gets injured? Somebody better, like, fine her. Be like, you will be fined in your contract if you leave that cell. You wrestle in there. But then I could just see her, like, trying to, like, hand climb out to the center of the ring and, like, drop an elbow drop.
Alright, we'll move right along from there. We had Cesaro versus Kofi Kingston. Following
Cesaro, who is apparently thick as fuck.
I was just, like, following a rather interesting little New Day promo
involving dick cereal and talk of the girth of Cesaro. So weird to talk a bunch of kids about that.
Yeah.
Feed them fucking dick cereal.
Alright, so Cesaro versus Kofi Kingston. Sheamus is on the outside. What was he, like, on? He was on Facebook. He was on Facebook Live the entire time.
Good gimmick.
I think that was fucking hysterical.
I'm kind of digging it. It's kind of like Odd Couple meets Miz and Mizdale.
Yeah.
So I like it. I like him. I said it before the thing. I thought they were going to be a tag team, and I'm kind of digging them as a tag team.
Yep, just got to... I definitely want to see more of it. I definitely want them to... Like, they can still, like, hate each other, but, like, they'll figure out how to work together, and, like, they'll learn that they can be a good tag team, but, like, they still...
I kind of already see a really cool finish once they're set up. Like, go into the big swing, and then you end the big swing with a, what do you call it? Like, where you grab their legs and kind of fall back and launch them up, like, right into a bro kick?
Yeah.
Like, as their finish?
I can see that. That'd be pretty cool.
Slingshot. That's what they call them. Like, the dang... So like that could be a really cool finish. I mean, gets the swing in there, because like the other option is a kick during the swing, but that could be pretty fucking dangerous.
Yeah.
So, a little bit of a botch by Kofi, but I don't really have an issue if the rest of the match is kind of clean, because it keeps high risk honest. Because if everybody's super crisp and clean on high risk moves,
there's
no high risk.
There was worse to shock in it.
Yeah, so I almost feel like wrestlers today could really use a botch. Like, just work it into your gimmick. Like, that's a good storytelling piece of thing. Like, I don't think I've ever seen anybody ever do that. Like, go for a springboard, you fuck it up the first time, then you keep, like, working the match, like, you hurt yourself on it, and then you build the courage to hit it the second time, and it works. Something like that could be good storytelling shit.
Yeah.
So, I dig it. I mean, obviously, Kofi had fucked up. It wasn't, you know, a planned spot, but... You know, I like it. I don't really mind as long as you're not consistently always fucking up.
Yeah.
Macho. Sorry.
But, yeah, Kofi picks up the win over Cesaro. You know, still giving a little bit of chance to let Cesaro and Sheamus breathe as a tag team. But it'd be pretty awesome if they ended up winning the tag belts kind of, like, aloofy. And then, like, the New Day are, like, freaking out about it. Like, they have no idea... They can't understand, like, how they lost when they're such good friends and they have such good synergy, whereas Cesaro and Sheamus don't even like each other. They can't stop, like, arguing. It would be really funny, I don't know if you would like this, but, like, if Cesaro and Sheamus are in the middle of, like, arguing and then they both hit a move and, like, that's kind of how they kind of escalate to, like, the end of the match and then they win.
Yeah, I could see something like that. I think, because... Another cool one is you've had them both kind of using a lot of submissions lately. So a crossface along with the cloverleaf could be a nice one too. And they're both just yanking and they're like, oh, I'm going to win. And he's like, I'm going to win. And you have like Xavier's like, oh God, just tap it out. He's like, then they're just like wrenching on it. Like that's how they pick it up. Like that could be pretty cool. Because I think Xavier's like the only one who could really sell that.
Yeah,
like,
yeah, yeah.
Please let me go. I'm sorry. You're both great. Just arm flailing around, tapping out. Oh, shit.
All right, so next up we had a Bayley squash match versus the most generic-looking female wrestler.
I think her name was Jenny Narek.
No. You wise guys, you. Yeah, her name was Cammy Fields.
Sorry, Cammy.
I like your name better.
Jenny Narek. Yeah, that's a power name right there. You can go far with that. Ask El Generico.
Yeah, so not much to say. It was a Bayley squash match. You know, just making Bayley look strong while she's got nothing really to do right now. All right. Speaking of El Bacho... We had Lince Dorado and Sin Cara versus Tony Nese and Drew Gulak.
So El Bacho teaming up with the Golden Dorito against... fucking Little Rufus and the Premier Athlete. Is that who it was?
Yeah.
Pretty solid little match. Who ended up winning? I don't remember.
It was the Luchadors.
Son of a bitch. Who took the pin? You know?
I can't remember.
Well, it wasn't young man Rufus. Little Rude.
Yeah, this was a nice little solid match, you know. Again, CWC guys, they just pull out quality matches. You know, it's hard to not like them.
Yeah, it's pretty fun little shit, I gotta say.
Yeah. I'm not sure when this happened, but we would then later get a promo. I'm just gonna say it now. We would get a promo with TJ coming to the back, talking to Brian Kendrick about, you know, the good times they used to have. And, you know, he doesn't think he's a bad person. And then Brian immediately going to attack him. TJ knocking him down, you know, shaking his head.
I feel like they kind of did this, like, before.
I feel like they did, too.
Yeah, like
this. But at the same time, you know, it's telling a story.
Yeah.
So Brian definitely is definitely full-blown heel. He's not just, it's not just a gimmick. He's
Kendrick,
really...
Kendrick, we should say.
Kendrick, yeah.
Because Brian could also mean...
Yeah.
Just
Mr.
So
Daniels.
Yeah.
So he's definitely trying to put it that, yeah, he is that kind of guy now. So it kind of gets some emotional shit going in there, but we'll get to more of that later on. We had Jericho, a little promo with them, with Stephanie McMahon and Mick Foley in his...
I think I, like... was like, I could use a drink. And I left during this. But I got the gist of it, if you will.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I could listen to fucking Chris Jericho talk about the list all day.
I get, like,
all day,
a lot
every
of people
day.
Really like it, but I don't know, just to me, it's just not my juju.
Know what that means, Dave? Do you want to know what that means?
What does that mean?
You just made the list! And I love it when, like, some, like when Xavier, like, when they were talking to the New Day about it.
No.
He doesn't want to do it. Like, that shit was fucking hilarious.
You see somebody actually publish the list?
Get out.
Yeah, it's like an actual picture.
And then, like, they talked about, like, just talking to Mick Foley. It's like, well, you know what, Foley? You just made the list. He's like, I'm already on the list. I freaking started the list. Oh my god, that was just like... Oh, I'm sorry.
So I guess this is the time to talk about it. What do you think of Mick Foley's plaid suit?
It was very, very Mick. The one thing I didn't quite was on top of was his slick back hair. I feel like just if he had just gone out like regular Mick, he would look fine.
Yeah.
Like, nobody would have... like, oh, this is Mick Foley. You know, he's wearing, you know, flannel suit. That's pretty rad. But... he had slick back hair, and everyone's like, what the fuck?
You look dirtier than normal. Somehow cleaning up made you look dirtier.
But, yeah, they had, like, a little back and forth. You know, I don't even remember what the fuck they were talking about.
They put,
Oh, right! Jericho. For the main event. For the main event. That's what it was. Thank you. Oh, there was a commercial, too. I can't remember when it happened, but... I know a lot of people really liked it, because there's a lot of, like, those advertisements. They're not usually very good. I thought this one was pretty good. I know the What Culture guys liked it.
Which one was this?
Oh, the Payday one with R-Truth and Jericho.
I think, like, I partially remember it. I don't know if I was, like, checking Facebook during this. Because I thought it was, like, a commercial, but I just remember looking up and, like, R-Truth is, like, slowly coming into frame.
Yeah,
because
he's talking about wanting a payday. He's like, I got you, man! He's like, no, you stupid idiot. I meant, like, an actual payday. He's like, oh, sorry, my bad. He walks away and he's like, doesn't mean I didn't want it. You know? Like, I thought that was pretty good.
That sounds pretty good. Eh? Like, they're both really funny guys.
Oh, yeah.
I can picture that being
Speaking good. Of R-Truth, next up we had R-Truth. Versus okay, it was a little bit before that because this match was based around Titus O'Neil not getting the deal to do the commercial. So he was mad at R-Truth for some fucking reason. They had a match.
Go ahead.
I think they gotta be doing a thing where Titus O'Neil keeps losing. Like, that's gotta be, like, his gimmick now. Where he's, like, all talking about the Titus brand and all this crazy dumb shit. But he's just going to keep losing. So he had a match with R-Truth. And R-Truth ended up picking up the win.
Can you see? You need some for the plot out classes?
This is what you give us. The rage is coming. Don't you worry.
Alright. So, next up, we had another Braun Strowman squash match.
You're getting a little bit of relief from the rage. Because I really like this match.
Instead of one guy, he fought, like, Beach Bum, Carrot Top, and an actual caveman.
The Splash Brothers? Which, yeah. As a fan of Critical, made me think of Splash TV. Just like, what if that's actually Critical and his friend that's in all the videos? Like, that would have been amazing if that was the voice that came out of him.
Hey, what's up, everybody? It's Critical. With the Splash Brothers. Today I'm going to be going in a handicap match with my good friend here, an actual caveman. Up against Braun Strowman. In case you guys didn't know who Braun Strowman is, he is basically a shaved Sasquatch with a pine cone shoved up his ass. He is probably going to tear my asshole in twain.
And he's like the Sasquatch from the fucking, what is it, Jack Lynx commercials? Like, he's his bigger brother.
Even more angrier.
Yeah. So, yeah, pretty solid little squash match. His running drop kick. Holy shit. Like, you just see the Splash Brothers and just like, oh no! They just like got booted. So you had the running power slam and then the super squisher. The reverse choke slam, if you will. And then Braun pinned a man who was doing a pin. So technically, the Splash Brothers lost via a Splash Brothers pin.
It's kind of like scoring at your own goal in soccer.
Yeah, he made a tag team beat themselves. But apparently, Monday still happened, so Braun's, his threat that next week wouldn't happen did not come to fruition.
Yeah, he gave him a slightly more competition, but apparently it wasn't good enough, so he's making another threat. So, who knows what we're going to get.
Hopefully a little bit of that Samoa Joe flavor we've been getting on NXT. I could go for a Braun Strowman run-ins to make things better. Where's Nia Jax? Second week in a row we haven't seen her.
Yeah.
I wonder if they're going to kind of pull back on her for a little bit until they're ready to put her in there.
I hope so. I mean, I was ready for her to do something, but...
Well, absolutely. I think they weren't... They probably decided that they were going to do the Hell in a Cell, and they didn't want to do Hell in a Cell with Nia and Sasha.
Right.
So... I think they felt like Charlotte deserved it. Fair enough.
Alright, speaking of which, we had the mixed tag with Roman and Sasha versus
rage.
Charlotte and Rusev.
Alright, so I gotta go off right the fuck away. I fucking hate mixed tags. They are the antithesis of good storytelling. Because there is no fucking way to do it. There is literally no way to do a mixed tag match and make it make any sort of fucking logical storytelling sense. There is no hot tag, which is like 99% of what a fucking tag match is. There's no double teams. There's nothing.
Props to our boy King Ross over at What Culture.
Oh, for the hot tag thing? Yeah. Well, believe me, I was pissed before I even saw his thing about it. Alright, so the whole thing was literally made to make Charlotte look like a complete retard. Because she keeps tagging herself in while Rusev is beating the absolute piss out of Roman Reigns. Does she not know how a fucking mixed tag match works? So, the finish of the match came, like, out of nowhere. Like, Roman got in very little offense. Sasha got in very little offense. But locked in her move. Rusev goes in to break it up. Roman spears him. So Rusev got no sort of, like, heat in this match. No one likes Roman. And the women's segment of it was only a couple seconds.
Right.
And the best thing you could say is Sasha got heat with fucking the other heel of the match when she tagged herself in. It was like, and she like immediately ran back to tagging Rusev.
Great. All
right. This is immediately when I took my controller and I went, why am I a wrestling fan, and changed the channel, and I didn't watch the rest of Raw. That's how angry I was. I was just like...
And so while my co-host is writhing, I will continue on to talk about... I completely understand his frustrations.
This was horrible. There's no other word for it. Do not ever do another mixed tag match. Until you have the fucking balls to just be like, this is an intergender match. Obviously, Roman's not going to punch fucking Charlotte in the head. He's going to, like, you know, back her into the corner. But Rusev's a dirty douchebag heel. He can grab Sasha, fuck with her. She gives him the low, and the referee's not looking. Tags in Roman, while Rusev's like, oh, my big fucking European balls. Roman hits his fucking running spear. There's your finish, no nuts. That's how you do it, you fucking idiots. There's ways to do it. He's a heel. Oh, no. We can't show a fucking guy because somebody out there probably thinks fucking Rusev is their hero. Nobody thinks that. He's a bad guy. Nobody knows it. Everything he does is a bad guy thing. He's like, oh, look at me. I hate America. I'm a foreigner from a country you don't know about. Ooh, my wife is pretty. Oh, I hate women. I have mutton chops. It's like, bad guy. Let him be a bad guy. He did no bad guy things. He literally just came out and was like, I don't much care for your thing. And then got no heat at all in the match. Bad match. Bad job. Be ashamed of yourself. Overbooked that. Stephanie, I know it's you. I know. I can smell it. Alright.
I'm not sure. Hold on.
Got that off my chest.
Can I help you?
All right, so you're gonna have to continue Raw without me.
She's wondering where, Finn Balor is this week. I'm sorry, sure, but Finn Balor's gonna be out for another few more months.
Yeah, I know there's just a lot of talk that he might not even be ready for the Rumble. Mm. Which would be too bad for him, because he would also probably be the guy to win it.
Yeah.
But if he's not back...
That's bullshit.
All right, so fill me in!
Alright, so immediately following, we had... Alright, because Goldberg was actually on with Coach on SportsCenter the other night. So he talked about how he would like to have... There's really nobody else he could really... I'm trying to remember exactly what he said, but he basically said he wanted to have another match with Brock Lesnar.
Yeah. And if you didn't know, there's been a lot of talk about it, because apparently... Goldberg's son never saw him wrestle. He must have been young to remember in WCW. And he wasn't in WWE for very long, and I'm sure he's not very proud of those matches.
Yeah.
Like, he was definitely a heat magnet during that time. Like, it's pretty known fact that Vince doesn't like Goldberg. He didn't make Goldberg, so fuck Goldberg.
Yeah.
And Nipple H was in his full Nipple H mood. I'm not putting anybody over. What's this? You beat 800 people or something? Yeah, I'm going to hit you with a sledgehammer.
So Paul Heyman comes out. He does a good little Paul Heyman promo. He basically challenges, or on behalf of Brock Lesnar, to a fight. So
I can give two squirts of piss about this match to watch two guys with a combined age of 100 have an old man match. Don't give a shit. Put over a young guy. I'm off the Lesnar bandwagon. I was never a Goldberg guy. My 100% feelings. I let the rage go from the other things. That's not just that speaking. I just... like, if he came back, Goldberg could have been the guy to put over Reigns.
Yeah.
Like, that's the one guy who would come back and I'd be like, makes sense. It wouldn't feel forced. Like, he comes back, he spears the bejesus out of Reigns in a match, and he's just like... You think you're the new young hot shit? I was the new young hot shit in my day. You think you're better than me? Like, this could be the thing.
Trip, where's all this crap in your fur? You don't go anywhere. You just sit up there all day. How do you have all this stuff in your fur? Goodness.
So, I do not give a shit about two old fucking dudes wrestling. Mm. Go to fucking Legends of Wrestling and have this match. I don't give a shit to see the Survivor Series.
So next up we had TJ Perkins and Aria Davari in a nice little C2C match. And again,
it's sounds like one I might end up fucking YouTubing to see.
Oh yeah, you definitely should. It's a good match, man. Just great match all around.
I love that his gimmick is he's like an Iranian evil bastard, but he's from Minnesota.
Like half the people, like, from...
From Iran, by way of Minnesota. Aria Davari.
Yeah, like every other person was, like, they're from a specific nationality, but they still live in, like, America.
Yeah. We have, like, the Bollywood boys there.
Well, yeah, they're
Canadian, and they're like, from Bombay, India. From the land of the Bombay.
From the magical land of India.
So, I'll have to go back and watch this. This sounds like it could be cool.
Oh, yeah. I highly recommend it. Again, CWC match. There's...
Not many bad ones.
I mean, I'm sorry, guys. Like, I'm not as good as calling out. I'm the JBL to his Mauro. Like, I'm just not that good at calling the stuff. Because I barely know what half the stuff is. And I have a very shitty memory, which is why I need to write the notes. So, I'm sorry I can't give more of a color commentation on what happened in the match.
I assume the champion goes over.
Oh, yeah. TJ wins the match.
What, the knee bar?
Yes.
I assume that's his finish. Yeah, it could be pretty fun.
Yep, I highly recommend it. It's a very good match. TJ, such a good wrestler. Like, it's... Then you have to be sad. Main event, Seth Rollins versus...
Yeah. Fuck you guys.
versus Chris Jericho. Now, this was a good little match, you know. Chris is just fucking... He's the best. He's the greatest heel ever. I don't care what anybody says. He is my favorite heel of all time.
So, is he your top guy right now? If you had to rank the WWE, is he your... Is he your number one? Is he your Patronus, if you will?
He might be, dude. Like, I'm just loving everything he's doing now. Like,
I've got Rufus as mine. You got Jericho?
I think it's got to be Jericho for me, man. No, right now, Bray Wyatt is still my number one guy. Okay. But Chris, just, oh my god, he is a solid number two. Like, I'm just loving everything that he's doing. I think he's fucking hysterical.
Yeah.
I don't even remember if we talked about it last week where he was doing... He walks off camera and then comes back around and does it. It's like, yeah. Like, that was beautiful. Like, that... Ugh. I cannot give him... And him and Kevin Owens.
Completely off topic, like, did you see that post that Tommy had made on Facebook? It was something about, like, how would you ask for sex without using the word sex? And, like, that's all I posted was, like, a Jericho meme. You just said it. That's what I posted. Alright, so how'd the match go?
It was cool. I liked it. You know, it was a little... I'm trying to remember what happened. Again, guys, I apologize. I thought it was a good match. You know, obviously Kevin Owens comes down about half, a little less than half.
Yeah, he's got
about three quarters of the way through. You know, I'm trying to remember what he did. But obviously, he ran a couple distractions. He didn't just do it once, like, he did a couple things. But Seth ends up going over in the end, and obviously he leaves.
Keeps it a singles match.
Kevin just kind of abandons Chris for the second time, or the third time, I can't remember. You know, so we're slowly getting those seeds of... breaking up Jericho.
Yeah.
You know, because they haven't really started fighting over, like, you'll hear them say, the Chris and Kevin blimp, you know, like, why don't we get a Chris and Kevin jet, McFoley? He's like, yes, I would love a team Kevin and Chris jet, you know, like, they keep kind of doing that.
I like it. It's definitely, like, good little running jokes and stuff like that. That's kind of stuff that keeps you interested.
Yeah.
They are two of the best mic workers.
So I gotta ask, as of right now, who do you think has the stronger champions? Raw or SmackDown?
Alright, let's see what they got.
You got...
Raw has... Their main champion
we're is... We're to discount the Cruiserweight champion just because there's nothing to compare them to on SmackDown. So you got...
Kevin is the main.
Yeah.
Kevin and AJ. Women's, you got Becky and Sasha.
Yeah, Beauty and the Beast and Usa... Or, New Day.
New Day. Then, Roman and Dolph.
I completely forgot Roman was the way to elevate that title after winning it from Rusev, who was like the fucking man wearing U.S. champ across his fucking dick. So, yeah. I completely forgot he was the champion. That's how much they put him over as the champion. Really elevating that title.
Sure. I gotta get up in a second. Alright, guys, we're gonna...
Well, you didn't say who you think.
Oh, it's...
I gotta say Raw as of right now.
I think they're just by slightly. Just slightly.
Yeah, I think the only one you could really make the argument on is the world title. I think AJ might be a little bit stronger than Kevin, but...
Yeah.
That's just my opinion. I know a lot of people love Kevin.
I guess...
On is the word we were looking for. A video cut, real quick. So...
Right.
Alright, so time for some, what do you got?
Let's do NXT. Just to...
NXT, Roar, Crown, Nugget, whatever. So we kicked off with another match in the Dusty Rhodes Tag Team Classic, baby.
The Glorious 10, which is Bobby Roode.
Goes to 10. That's 10 for them. There you go. Glorious 10. You could have hopped up and like did the ass thing. Could have twerked for them.
Yeah, for being a big guy, I do not have an ass.
And you can't twerk for these boys?
No. Like, I have quite the pancake ass for being a large gentleman. As I have been told by my wife. So.
There you go. Put that out there.
Not exactly the,
what you consider your dad to be makes sense. He calls his dad Hank Hill.
Yeah, my, like, every time, like, I spoof my dad's voice, it's always Hank Hill. Like, it's, what do you mean you don't know how to grow potatoes?
Alright, so let's continue on.
Alright,
it was the Glorious 10 versus
the debuting stable, they're not even attacking, it's a stable of people called Sanity. And I immediately dig their gimmick. They kind of remind me, like, kind of like monstery kind of street toughs.
Yeah, it feels very 90s to me, but
yeah,
wasn't bad.
It's they're kind of like Decay without like all of the craziness about it.
They kind of feel like if you smashed Decay with the Aces and Eights.
It's right on. So I can't remember what the two guys were.
You remember Sawyer them? Fulton and Alexander Wolf. Oh.
So they were the two guys going in, and you had this cute little thing next to them.
Sharon Glenn Cross.
Thank you. So, according to you, you said she's a pretty decent...
Yeah, I know a lot of people were hyping her up when
so
she first came.
That's always good to hear. So, basically, this was just a squash.
And their shadowy leader, who would be revealed by the end of the match.
Which I'm actually pretty proud of myself for figuring out who it was just by the vest alone. So this was, like I said, this was pretty much a squash.
So
like
I'm going to give Sanity the compliment sandwich, a good thing and a bad thing, and then a good thing.
Yeah.
So, good thing, the look and everything about it, they feel different. So I can dig that.
Yep.
Bad thing, I didn't like their fire. For, like, crazy heels, I don't know, they just kind of felt a little, like, standard.
Yeah.
But I like the corner spot with Sawyer Fulton, like, smashes him into the corner, and then Wolf climbs up on his back and starts like...
That was so...
That felt like good crazy...
I was digging that. That was...
Yeah, that felt like... I could see that being what two crazy people would do. Like, granted, brand new to TV, I assume that's something somebody's going to pull him upside and be like, this was good, this wasn't. Clean this up a little bit, keep this thing. And
so,
keep going.
Like I said, poor Ty Dillinger was just getting beat on the entire match.
Bobby Roode's still wearing his glorious bathrobe. Comes into the ring...
And he's like,
goes face to face with Sawyer Fulton, who is a 6'8 man.
He's like, boy. With
dreadlocks and ridiculousness.
That's it. It's like the little middle section of just dreadlocks, and the rest of his head was shaved. And he's just like,
he puts his robe back on.
He just walks away.
Because he's got to like out and open a little bit, and he just closes it, tightens his belt thing, and leaves.
Yeah, so definitely, I mean, obviously you called he was going to betray him at some point. Definitely, it wasn't as violent as we thought it was going to be, but that ended up being fucking CN's deal.
So the finish was a combination of a vertical suplex and a power slam at the same time. At first I was like, are they going to do a magic killer? But they had their own little move. It works for me. Maybe a little bit more snap on it. But it wasn't bad at all, especially for the first time on TV. You never know if they're going to stick with that as their finish or not. But it worked for me, so cool shit. After the match, the little one, as they call this person, because at this point you don't know it's a woman unless you're mean, you have... I'm not going to name it because I'm sure it offends somebody, but I can sense it. So I was like, oh, that's a woman. And then she jumps on him and beats his ass because... Swiss couldn't do this.
And then their leader, who was then revealed to be Eric Young.
With a new finish, it's a wheelbarrow neck breaker. Cool little shit. If that is actually going to be his finish, it's a pretty cool little one.
I was always a fan of Eric Young back when I actually gave a shit about TNA. I just liked his little array of gimmicks that he had, you know.
Yeah.
So I was sad for the last couple months because we haven't seen him since he first came to NXT, but now he's in a cool stable that I'm totally digging. Very excited to see where they're going forthwith. So that being said, we'll move right along to
It feels like they could already position him to be a top guy too, which is good because it's just kind of assumed Samoa Joe is going up here pretty soon. I assume he's losing to Nakamura and then he's going to the main roster. I don't know why I made a fart sound like he was being fired. Like, oh, you lose the match, and then, just get the indies, bro. I assume SmackDown. I assume that's where he's going. So I assume people... I'm making a lot of assumptions. I get it. Shut up. So, I just think SmackDown needs warm bodies. I've been saying it for a while. They're just a little short on talent right now. So, Joe to SmackDown would be pretty awesome.
Alright, so, like I said, next up we have Billy Kay... Nerd blue velvety goodness versus
with Peyton Royce.
Peyton Royce.
Mm. All right.
Versus Discount Carmella Liv Morgan.
Yeah. she's slowly morphing more and more into her. Like, I don't understand how WWE doesn't like
see it.
My gosh, she's doing a lot of the same stuff as somebody else, but I can't remember.
No, it's okay. Staten Island and New Jersey are two different things.
No one could ever confuse those two things. They're only, like, a bay away. So, yeah. She even does, like, the running, like, screamy, spinny thing that Carmella does. Like, she did it in this match. It was just not good. I know that she has her fans, and I think I know why she has those fans. Fair, I get it. I've been attracted to people before, but she is just not good. She is, I don't know, she might be in that Eva Marie level.
Ooh.
Like,
That's pretty harsh.
She's
just that bad. Jesus Christ, man, that's just mean.
I think Eva might be better.
Ooh.
Like, I'm trying to think what she does well. She threw a absolute shit clothesline. You can't do a clothesline right, which is literally raise your arm and run. Like, I don't know what to say. She took a big boot well. She's got an entrance down. I'm fucking reaching for compliments for Liv. Jesus Christ. Mary and Joseph, she is just not good. Because I thought she would be the next, Carmella, but she might be the second coming of Eva Marie because Mandy is apparently pretty solid, got to say. Alright, so let's continue on before I keep just shooting all over. So,
alright, next match was...
Ashitoka beat Boot and lost, yeah. So the two Australian tall girls win. Speaking of Australians, more Australians.
We got TM61 versus Riddick Moss, and who you consider to be the newest member of your boys' stable, Tino Sabatelli. Did I say that right?
Yep. And Tino was far and away the most over person in the match. They, like, really are trying to get TM61 over, but they have no personality whatsoever. Like, they are just floundering. Like, they have a little bit of, like, a... I think it's more that people just think it's fun to do, like, the oi, oi, oi thing than they're actually over.
Yeah, I don't mean to break this up or anything. I'm looking because I had my PS4 on. Our friend Annie got the fucking Rapid Discord thing.
All you need to do, really, is...
It's like, fucking hard, though. All you need to do. It's fucking hard. I've seen videos upon videos of guys doing it and be like, yeah, I'm here to... I'm trying to do the Rapid Discord.
Well, since
I'm
you've
not
got his buff and damage, it's a lot easier to do.
Oh, sorry about that, guys.
You just need to have a team without a bunch of tanks.
Alright, so, anyway.
Less Overwatch, more NXT.
Alright,
so yeah, so TM61 pretty much dominated this match. Riddick Moss, your gimmick is linebacker. Why are you not using shoulder tackles? But Tino, because apparently he was a Buccaneer and most of these shows are done in Tampa Bay area. Like, I think it's north of Orlando. Like, I think they say Orlando, but I don't think it's actually in Orlando.
No.
So you have Tampa Bay fans around there. So he was getting a pretty solid mixed chant. Some people were really into him. Obviously, some probably lost money on him. But Corey Graves, who I usually shit on because he pisses me off on a lot of stuff, he did a pretty good job putting both the new guys over, letting us know. More so Tino, and I think it makes sense. He's better just all around. Like, they were talking about how he arrived today in, like, a brand new custom suit, and he drives a white Maserati, and he's a legit millionaire. I'm like, man, that's some good heat right there. And he's getting just, he's getting the John Cena treatment of, like, the young ladies in the crowd looking at Captain Abs. And they're like, Tino, and then, he sucks. Fuck that guy. So, like, it's a pretty solid little thing. Tino's power slam, like, from the outside to the inside, good shit. Neither one of them really got a chance to do a whole lot of offense, so I don't know if they're just worried they're too green.
Yeah.
And you don't want to hurt Tino with 6-1
for whatever
in the future. And again, I gotta point out every time I see a fucking TM61 match, why is it Thunder Valley? Why is it not the Thunder Down Under? God damn it. I hate you all. Let's move on. So, from that Australian to another Australian, Shitter's Clogged Buddy Murphy. Just a fucking all Australia NXT, effectively. So, Shitter's Clogged versus the Bodacious One, beautiful blonde Blake Murphy. Blake, Wesley Blake, that's the guy. Whatever.
Both last names are Murphy.
Yeah, they deserve it. They deserve to be
shit. Like, I'm Buddy Murphy. I'm Blake Murphy. No relation.
Yeah. No relation.
That would be a fucking great gimmick.
No relation. Yeah, that could be pretty fun. So, alright. So they have, like, a little bit of a kind of jokey thing. This was the goddamn main event. And it went way too long to have an interrupted finish.
Yeah.
Of Joe just coming out kind of like shit tossing them. Be like, Nakamura, give me my title. Oh, you're not here. So Regal, you do it. And then Nakamura comes out and he's just like. So then they kind of do the little brawl thing. Security made up of all like the in training guys. Goddamn Mata from Tough Enough wearing suit pants. Blue striped suit pants. Fucking jabron. Oh, yeah, he stood way out between being, like, a fucking Middle Eastern dude with a blonde mohawk and wearing, like, blue silk striped pants, being the only one in there with those kind of pants on. Like, Jesus Christ. So, yeah, it was, you know, yeah, whatever. So, it pretty much just set that thing up. So, apparently Nakamura is fine.
Right.
That was pretty much it. So, let's kick it up. Show them all the things that we can do. Let's kick it up together.
Alright. Yeah. And, we'll finish this up with Lucha Underground. This wasn't a very story-driven show.
Yeah, just kind of a couple matches. Or, technically three matches and a...
Not bad matches at all. Very good show today.
Yeah, it wasn't weighed down by a, 2 out of 3 or whatever the fuck.
Yeah.
Best of 5 series, that's the fuck they're doing.
Yeah, Tejano and Cage, so that wasn't around today. But we'll probably get that next week, but... Starting off, great match, fun match, was Famous B and Dr. Wagner Jr. versus Son of Havoc and Mascarita Sangrada.
So I gotta point out the entrance.
The entrance. So fucking
Son of Havoc comes in.
Radical dudes.
With a motorcycle with a sidecar. Great shit.
Oh my god, that was... Loved it. Absolutely loved it. That was fantastic.
So the match itself, Mascarita is kind of like a, he's like more of an attraction than a wrestler, really.
Mm.
He's a little, I don't know, they kind of try to build him up as more than he really is.
Yeah.
But really this was about, like, if we could get Son of Havoc and Dr. Wagner, I got a feeling like we could have some really good stuff. Like, we got a little taste of it at the end of last season, but a good feud between those two could be really fun.
Yeah, I would love to see... I have really, because I know Wagner's a huge star.
Yeah,
I've never really seen that much of him. I've only heard of
him. Yeah, he's mostly straight up out of Mexico. Like,
yeah.
He's a regional. It's kind of insulting, I guess, to say, like, oh, the top brand in Mexico is regional, but, like, you don't really get Mexican, like, pay-per-view in the States. It's not like saying, like, you're the biggest thing in Japan. Like, it's not like WWE that goes out and is bigger than them in their own countries.
Right.
Like, it's kind of hard to compare it. Like, it'd be like saying he's the top guy from TNA, effectively. Actually, I would probably say Triple A's bigger than TNA. I don't know. Yeah, I guess I would. I don't know. Like, the top guy in ECW, I guess. If you didn't watch ECW. So, yeah, pretty solid match. The finish is Mascarita Sagrada and Son of Havoc are going to go for some sort of top rope. Probably the Fortunate Son, a.k.a. the Shooting Star, but Wagner pushes him off. Then he goes and hits his snowplow doctor, whatever, his finish. But then he gives the tag to Famous B so he can get his first ever victory inside the temple with a two-finger stethoscope pin. Good shit. Beautiful Brenda. She sounds like Harley Quinn.
Slightly more annoying Harley Quinn, but...
Yeah, she's got like the same kind of accent and everything.
Yeah,
I was just like... And she's yelling, poor baby.
Yeah. Like, I don't give a shit about the accent. Like,
I could be about that, too.
Yeah.
It's like Vampiro's like, oh, she's so annoying. Who would want her out here? In sexy lingerie running around. Boo! Boo us!
We gay Vampiro? Not that there's anything wrong with that.
Be all about beefcake.
I mean, it's just like...
I don't know. Yeah, but it's just like, it's a weird thing. It's kind of like when they were like, oh, that dirty cheat Lana. Who'd want her out here in her skin-tight suit?
Yeah, it's like... Boo, yes, because I
sent her to the back.
You know, it's like... Being as a guy who likes women, it's like... Yeah.
It's always kind of a weird thing in wrestling when they're like, oh, you're the heel valet, so people are supposed to boo you. But no one really wants to see you leave. So, yeah. Pretty solid little match. So we move right into another really good match with Jack Evans, the Dragon Slayer, and the future Star Destroyer, as he decided to name himself, against Sexy Star. This was kind of a Jack Evans showcase. Like, Sexy did some cool stuff, but really this was Jack Evans, like, kind of wrestling around.
Give him a little time to shine, you know?
he had a good match, you know. And we all know Sex Star is good, you know. We didn't really need any proof of that, but Jack Evans kind of, you know, hasn't been getting that much time in the limelight.
So I got to talk about some, not really a spoiler, but probably stuff people wouldn't want to know about because it'll affect the season 4 tapings. Did you hear about PJ Black broke both his ankles? He was base jumping, something went wrong and broke both his ankles.
Oh.
So he might not ever be the same in wrestling, which is a shame. Because in my opinion, he might have been the best member, like in terms of pure wrestling.
Oh my god, that's...
Like, I think Jomo is still the best guy. Like, he's got the personality to go with all of his...
Oh, that kind of hurts. Like, oh my god.
Then you got Jack Evans broke his jaw during this tape. So it's like... And apparently, Ty is also injured, so it's like...
Get that, you're fucking kidding me.
So, like, Worldwide...
Come on.
Worldwide Underground is just, like... I mean, maybe hers is just a work thing, but it sounded like
it
she was legitimately
be.
Injured at the end of that taping.
Ugh.
Like, you don't generally, like... Injured thing is like, oh, my knee. When she was, like, screaming and they carried her to the back. Like, they just didn't act like the way heels would... You know, you
yeah.
get her up and get her out of there.
They would have time to snicker and be like, ooh, we'll get you next time, you know, but they didn't do any of that.
She was
week.
Screaming pretty loud. Like, that's the kind of thing where you're like, oh, shit, what happened?
Yeah.
But also, because this match must have been taped before that match, obviously because Jack was talking, but also, Sexy didn't have any sort of, like, because I was kind of curious to see if this was going to be after it, because I wanted to see what her eye looked like, because it was definitely... fucked up after that Atomicos match.
Mm-hmm.
But all in all, this is a pretty solid match. The Worldwide Underground kind of came out. PJ Black was wearing, I don't even know what to fucking describe that. Like, those things called like a sarong? Sarong? Like the fucking skirt thing that you tie around yourself? I think that's what he was wearing.
Yeah, I don't know what it's called, but yeah, I know what you're talking about.
Like, I think maybe he was just wearing, like, really cut-up shorts. Honestly, I have no fucking clue what he was wearing, but it was something fucking weird. And then, Jomo was wearing a, I guess I should call him Jomu. Mundo. He was wearing, like, a lot of red. And I gotta give him super props for the cheating and then sliding under the ring but being able to hear the count and then rolling out and be like, what kind of hell did she kick out? So,
yeah, that was
good shit. But I have to give a giant fuck you to Phoenix. He should have gotten the disqualification. He just ran into the ring. The referee's like, what are you doing? And then, like, Sexy grabbed the kendo stick and hit Jack Evans in the groin and then just dropped it. She didn't throw it out of the ring or anything. He's just like, ugh. She's got a stick next to her. Like, the referee's just like, fuck. But one other point that was really good. Jack had her in, like, a modified butterfly. So he had, like, her arms pinned behind her back. And he's moving her mouth, speaking Spanish. That was pretty funny.
Yeah.
I have to say, that's a good spot.
Yeah.
Like, it works for his character.
Yeah.
Like, he feels like a more athletic version of what Dean Ambrose should be.
Yeah.
Where he's kind of like playing with people.
Can I help you?
Alright, so main event time. Earlier in the show, we saw Chavo take out Dragon Azteca Jr. with a steel chair, and Baroness sent him to the hospital. So.
Chavo!
Chavo! So Dario and Chavo comes in and he's like, I should get the match. I want to wrestle him. And then Ray comes in and he's like, I want to wrestle you. And he's like, well, I also don't like you. And he's like, oh. And they're like, like wrestling. And Dario's just like, this is pretty cool. And he's like, all right, I've got an idea. You all three wrestle. Hopefully one of you die. Get the fuck out of my office. And then we go sniff the ring announce girl. And then he leaves. So we have a triple threat for the main event. And I know what I've been saying about triple threats, but this one worked. It made sense.
Yeah.
The storyline. Because everybody hates each other. So it kind of worked.
That first bit where, like, and then Ray just flips them both off.
Yeah. Yeah, they definitely made Rey feel like the star. They definitely protected Chavo as, like, his character is kind of like a lie, cheat, and steal, but he's not, nobody likes him. Yeah. He's not like, he's like what Eddie would be if nobody liked Eddie. He's like, I lie, I cheat, I steal. I'm like, yeah, and you're a dick.
Why would you do those things?
Yeah, it's like, dastardly asshole.
Like, so, what? That's illegal.
Yeah.
How would you admit to that?
Hold on, we had two detectives here, undercover. So, yeah, pretty solid little match. At the end, your winner is Pentagon Black, and he goes to break Rey's arm, but Rey reverses it, kicks his ass out of the ring. But then Chavo comes in, takes out Rey, and then takes out Rey's knee with a steel chair. Pretty tame. I gotta assume Rey's knees are still...
Yeah.
On the weekend, because he didn't take much of a shot.
You know,
like immediately being like, "Oh, my knee, it's broken, shattered, in million pieces." So yeah, it was a little weak sauce for the attack. Because I remember the original Rey and Chavo feud where Chavo put Rey like on the Tron, like jammed his leg just like that inside of it, hung him upside down, and just kept whacking him on the knee, and like Vicky had to come out. There's all these people that are like, no, no, or no more. And he's just, like, pushing them to the side, smashing. He's like, he's my uncle. He means more than me. Like, just smashing knees.
So, I remember that, man.
Obviously what this was supposed to remind you of.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
What did you think of Matt Stryker name-dropping the Cruiserweight title in WWE?
That was kind of interesting.
A little surprising. Like,
yeah.
Like, yes, you can't really talk about them without mentioning WWE, but it just felt weird.
But he also didn't say WWE, so...
Yeah, he's like, or they wrestled for the Cruiserweight Championship. Who knows where? Could have been anywhere, I guess.
Could have been the Magical Land of India.
Yeah. Like, he's like, I'm pretty sure that's where they got their start. Like, maybe I was like, you fucking idiot. They got their start in Mexico, and there were wee lads handing out peanuts, and their dads wrestled...
That was pretty good. Like, he basically was like, the fuck are you talking about, man?
You're not the brightest. I also like that, like, Matt Stryker goes to Vampiro like he thinks Vampiro's from Mexico. Despite the fact his name's Ian Hodgkinson. It's not fucking, like, Jose Gonzalez Espinoza Rodriguez. He's just like, so how is your Spanish? Like, well, I'm from, like, Michigan, so I think it's pretty good, I guess. Like, I get he's like a legend in Mexico.
It's like, dude, just because I speak fluent Spanish doesn't mean I am from fucking Mexico.
It'd be like if Funaki was wrestling and, like, JBL was like, Stan, how's your Japanese? Tell me, Stan Hansen. It's just like, what? It's so weird.
Yeah.
Like, I get it, he probably does speak really fluent Spanish, but it's just like, tell me, Vampiro, you would know. So, yeah, pretty solid little thing. All right, so, last kind of things to kind of wrap up this before we end the video.
Wrestling news!
The big one, obviously, this Wednesday on Arrow will be the episode with Cody, where he plays a Stardust dealer. Who has an accident and becomes a very large, muscular man for Oliver Queen to wrestle. Or fight. So, yeah, definitely check that out. I like Arrow to begin with, so I'll be checking it out anyways. I don't think there's anything else really worth talking about. Yeah. So, which one?
Paige.
That's what I was thinking. Paige got her second suspension, and I guess...
She is undergoing surgery.
Yeah, she's going to get neck surgery, but apparently her dad went on Twitter and, like, pretty much said that she should quit WWE and come home because American healthcare, which I don't think he was really talking so much about, like, America sucks and, like, our European healthcare is better, but it sounded more like WWE is not doing what it should be, which could be true if, you know, if he's like, why are they screwing around with all these other treatments? She needs neck surgery.
Yeah.
Because he's, I'm sure, been in the business for fucking ever, and he can just kind of look at something and tell what's going on. Plus, it's his little girl, so I can't exactly blame him for being pissed off. But maybe this will be the thing. And then also, the controversy around Alberto Del Rio stabbing apparently he keeps changing the story.
Oh.
So a lot of people are suspecting that maybe it's somebody who he doesn't want to say. Because apparently the original story was it was a road rage incident. The second story was he got robbed and they stole his wallet. And the third story is he was robbed, but they took his phone, and it was like something else in the story had changed.
Oh.
Because that's the story he told AAA, like why he couldn't make the showing, because apparently the stabbing was the day before.
Ooh.
Like, granted, they weren't going to clear him. Like, go get in there, bandage man. Go wrestle a match.
Oh.
So.
Oh, God, I hope that's...
So, I mean, I'm not going to say it was...
I know what you're thinking.
But...
I know what I'm thinking.
But
I know
it
what
just seems really suspicious when you keep
changing the story. I am really hoping that that is not the case. That would fucking suck.
But that's kind of the immediate thought that pops into people's heads when one person keeps changing their story of how they got cut a bunch of times, generally to protect somebody, or it's because they're afraid of somebody.
Yeah, it's effectively the...
when you're a 6'5 legit fighter, I don't think he's particularly afraid of too many people.
Yeah. It's effectively the walked into a doorknob.
Yeah.
Or fell down the stairs type of thing, so... Yeah, here's hoping that's not the case, and he's...
Yeah, I mean, it could be anything. It could be, you know, a brother, or a sister, or mom, something
family-related. Somebody less sexy.
Yeah, somebody who doesn't quite look so good in a lot of black makeup. You know, did it, and he just doesn't want them to go to prison. You know, whatever. You could have his reason. Could be a friend who got drunk and,
yeah,
like, just smashed a bottle over his arm and gave him some pretty bad cuts. You never know. It could be some reason, but... Immediately after all the issues Paige has been having, it doesn't look good for her. Let's just say that. I'm trying to think if there's any last things before we end this video. I don't really think so. TNA effectively has taped their future, I guess you could say. So, spoilers, we're going to end the video after this, so if you're a TNA fan, you can kind of roll on to the sunset, leave us a like if you would be so kind, and maybe subscribe if you want to hear more of this kind of stuff. Later. Alright, comes the TNA spoiler, so don't,
We gotta... It's gonna cut out on us again.
Well, I've only got a couple seconds. I just want to say, they, changed up the titles. Billy Corgan is now in charge. Dixie's not in charge at all. And they changed all the titles, effectively.
Oh, wow.
So, Moose picked it up from Sandow, whatever his new name is. Hardy's kept their title. Decay Girl is their women's champion.
Oh, wow.
And Eddie Edwards, Captain Great Name, beat Bobby Lashley.
So. All right, guys. So, we got to wrap it up just before it cuts out on us. So, Super Touch Funk, Dave. See you guys later.